Well, thank you everybody for joining us here today. We've got a great panel. We're going to get right into it. We're going to start. I'm going to have my panelists here each introduce themselves. Then we'll jump into questions. I've got a bunch of questions. We were just talking about, I think we could go all afternoon easily. But we'll try and make sure we leave some time from questions from all of you, and there'll be a mic that circulates in the audience. So Ray, let me hand it over to you.
Okay, great, thanks. I'm Dr. Ray Attir. I am the Chief of Cybersecurity for the Marine Corps. I'm also the Marine Corps' authorizing official. My responsibilities are the whole cybersecurity program, from policies, tasks, standards, oversight, you know, compliance. I've been in the career for about 30, a little over 30-some years, 14 years in this particular position. And I've got a staff of about 35 people worldwide. And I focus just on the cybersecurity aspects and attributes of the Marine Corps capabilities. So it's really good to be with everybody, and I'm looking forward to your questions also after our presentation.
Okay, so I'm Ed Ryan. I'm a program manager in the cybersecurity division at the Department of Homeland Security Science and Technology. And I've got several efforts that are related to today's discussion. One, I've got a really fun program in building cybersecurity competitions. So if you've heard of the National Collegiate Cyber Defense Competition, that's one that came out of our job, as well as the U.S. Cyber Challenge. We've also got some efforts looking at better ways to evaluate not only students, but also current workforce or potential workforce. And then my more, shall we say, technically focused effort is on federated command and control for network defense. And that gets into different ways of changing enterprise networks and looking across enterprises so that you're doing information sharing so that you have a global view. So I like to say it's a global view with local decision making. And the whole point is to actually start putting moving target defenses or flexible adaptive defenses into enterprises so that you can react to, say, your neighbors getting attacked on something and you're actually better protected.
And Stephen Denson from HSARPA, like Ed. And I work in the Data Analytics Engine, which is a cross-cutting investment in data analytics on behalf of the department and the science and technology programs. I have a laboratory there, a lot of different subject matter experts, diversity of subject matter experts there, working on a variety of challenges the department faces with respect to utilization of data, some of that being cyber data, for different applications. And so there's a whole lot going on there. We have an in-house laboratory where we can bring in data sets, explore what's really going on with real problems, develop real problem statements, and then go after solutions that can address those. And I think that's a big part of it, is understanding both the technology and the problem in its full reality in order to deploy a solution that makes sense and can actually work. So one joke I tell often before we get started is that, you know, HSARPA is like the Homeland Security version of DARPA, just a lot of less money, so we don't have as much to invest. It makes us scrappy and gritty.
That's great. And I'm Joe Pasqua. I run the product team at MarkLogic, so all the folks who design, build, document, support, test MarkLogic's NoSQL database are in my organization. And I was just mentioning to our panelists that before MarkLogic, I ran the global security research team at Symantec for a number of years, so the security area is near and dear to my heart as well. And actually, earlier this morning, I was also talking about cloud. And no discussion of cloud can happen without a discussion of security. So let's jump in and, you know, sort of beyond the economic considerations, when your organizations are thinking about utilizing the cloud, what are some of the things that are going through your heads about how to get the most out of it and how to do it safely? Ed, do you want to start?
Sure. So, I think cloud gives a very, I wouldn't say unique, but a very good opportunity to start adding other controls as far as dynamics. The cloud industry is based on the fact that you've got availability and you can scale up and down capacity-wise. Your schedulers are based on load balancing. There's also an opportunity, though, because in that dynamic environment, to add in security. So if you've got indicators that somebody's perhaps gotten into a specific application, well, then you can just start up a new one from a gold standard image, get rid of the old one, and then potentially that attack is now gone. so you're able to very quickly start to mitigate any threats that may be in your environment. But then, you know, other challenges, you know, as far as COVID and residency, and you know, how do you know that you have static control, and you know, some other challenges, so you know, hardware based as well.
And Ray, in the Marine Corps, what do you think about in terms of cloud and cloud considerations?
You know, we've been working on our own cloud construct for a while, a hybrid version, primarily out of Kansas City, working maybe to our private and hybrid kind of blending. But our approach is that we're looking at this as to how do we move our acquisition processes, how we move our current programs of record to into a more of a safe, more updated capability, so that we can take in upgrade applications quicker, we can make sure that security is folded in quicker, get off of the waterfall construct that we do development, and then security at the end, but actually put security at each of the phases. The project for us is our application development and test environment, and it'll be in Kansas City. So that's how we're looking at how we can, it helps the economic part too, as we're talking about, but it also means that I can get products out quicker. And if there's an issue in the security part, I can actually respond to that quicker as well. Once it's fielded, I see a problem. We know what the deltas are. We get it back to the developer, the program manager. They can take it to the update, and then boom, push that new capability out. So that's how we're trying to be a little more aggressive and agile.
So this is interesting. When we talk about the cloud in general, usually the conversation drifts towards what are my security threats in the cloud. And what I've heard both of you just say is, there's opportunities in the cloud to actually advance our security. So, Stephen, any
thoughts? Yeah, absolutely. So we went through the process of building a system for ICE that we deployed in Full Metal. It takes about 9 months to deliver a system to a data center and fully deploy it. And then we took that experience and compared it to what it would take to bring up the same kind of capability in the cloud. I think our operational customers still have a lot of questions about the opportunity with respect to security. So they're a little bit more guarded and conservative, you know, when it comes to adopting, you know, emerging best practices and moving quickly to the cloud. So it's a very slow and studied response to cloud opportunity. But I think also that you know, we were able to document maybe a 30% savings in cost by going to the cloud. Certainly the ease of management, the switching costs go down, so your ability to move your data into a different software environment to create a new data flow. The opportunities are much more rapidly responded to as opposed to delivering yet another box to a data center and going through that entire process. So to me, there's many opportunities for scalability there and also an ability to keep up with innovation, you know, as it's going. From an R&D perspective, we worked on all the security issues up front, you know, so that by the time you're getting deployment in the ATO, everybody fully understands what that is. I think the same opportunities there in the cloud probably times 10.
Right. And just sort of a general gestalt, how are organizations feeling about the cloud these days? Are people feeling generally positive? This is a good thing. We want to take advantage of it. Are they afraid of the cloud? How are organizations feeling about the cloud?
Well, I know within ours, it's kind of a mixed bag. Fundamentally, to get into the joke we say is, what is cloud? Is somebody running my data on their system at another location? So there's naturally the fear they have of loss of control and management. There's issues of, well, I'm going to change this model. What am I doing with my budget line? Maybe I'm going to have less workers that I have. Maybe the control in my department has got to go someplace else. So there is a little bit of reluctance there. But there's also some excitement. We've got a concept we're thinking about in the Marine Corps of how do I take and, if you will, use a tactical cloudlet. Or I can take a capability, put my cloud information into it, and have it move forward with Marines, with our special purpose mag task, with our Muse. So now instead of reaching back through satellite connections back into the cloud environment or to the garrison environment, they've actually pulled that material and they're getting cloud-like capability with that data that they pulled in from Kansas City, and they can get it what they need as they deploy and as they work, as data is updated. You know, the disadvantaged connections and such, it gets remotely updated periodically, but you can come back, clean it out, and next group goes out, take that tactical cloudlet and put more information into it. So the construct of having it at one location and having it available to others at distance relatively distant locations is kind of exciting to people when they start looking at it from a tactical perspective.
And those clouds are your clouds.
Yes.
So you're not just a cloud consumer, you're a cloud provider. Mm-hmm. That's great. So what sort of experiences have you gained in terms of being a cloud provider as well? Or let me say it this way. In being a cloud provider, has that influenced that the way you look at other public cloud providers?
Well, truth in advertising, we're not a cloud provider yet. This is all on the edge of development and work and testing and planning and kind of do some field experience. But it does make us look at other opportunities by saying if there's a capability that we need and if it's something we haven't been able to develop or work within ourselves yet, maybe there's other opportunities to bring in more of the our industry partners into it to kind of build into the hybrids. So we're actually looking at aspects, what is the capability? What is the agreements we would have? You know, what are the security patterns we'd have to agree to? And some of the SLAs and the contracts and such. So we're starting to kind of look at these things broadly, but we're moving slowly because we're very cautious. We've had instances in the past where we've not had the best experiences in things. And we want to make sure that we get the best experience, particularly when our Marines go forward and have to use this data.
Right. Makes perfect sense. And, you know, you've all brought up an interesting point as part of your discussion, which is there's a completely non-technical aspect to this. There's an organizational aspect. There's a cultural aspect. Can you say a few words about within your organization, what does that piece of the puzzle look like in terms of getting the non-technical pieces in order?
So that's the easy part, right? No, I mean, changing people's minds and behaviors is always very difficult. So, you know, you talked about, you know, you're going to take my data and put it where? I mean, that's a big concern. So, you know, we have a significant number of efforts looking at privacy-preserving methodologies, whether it's computations or storage. And if you trust the math, then you'll trust that, you know, it's there. So a lot of it is, you know, confidence in the ability to understand what's going on and that you're not actually just shipping it to somebody else. It's that they can look at it. It's they're holding it for you.
Yeah, so certainly that privacy piece is very important and making sure that folks in that world understand the privacy concepts that surround some new application is an education process. There's all the building of trust, the governance issue, if you're bringing multiple data sets together, who owns the data? You know, how do you keep ownership, the concept of ownership alive while you're virtualizing data collections might be an important thing to work out. And then there's the whole maturity level discussion. You know, how mature is the organization with respect to its networks and its data? How mature are the analysts, you know, as they gain access to information? So that's a broader discussion. And so for us, you know, when we're targeting transition of technology, we're working in an R&D environment, we're trying to transition what it is that we've created so it goes into use. That's really important for us. And so we're often targeting, you know, our deliveries to the maturity levels in order to make sure that it actually can transition and add value to the mission.
I think there's also the policy part, too. I mean, this you know, we can't get away from the paperwork part as much as we want to, and that is the non-technical part. But as we've described here, these various steps and processes, we've got to make sure that we put it into policy that's clear to understand, people know what's expected of them, and it's championed and supported by leadership, that we don't have people at the very end, as I was talking earlier, like my granddaughter looking at us and going, no. Yeah, you want to make sure that's there and it's enforceable, so you can actually get movement done.
Yeah, that's a very important point, the policy piece, because I think technology is moving so fast that a lot of times even the policy framework for how we're going to deal with these technologies hasn't shown up. And so we've driven discussions around, you know, autonomy, autonomous systems, you know, how are you going to make decisions about liability and risk communication, and if you're doing high consequence decision making, these are all very important factors.
Yeah. And then trying to find somebody that's willing to actually go do the work, and so finding a champion is very, very key.
That's huge.
Yeah. Luckily, Steve's been able to take some of our products in his hands.
So, Steve, you mentioned a couple of things like about governance, for example, and part of your mission involves sharing data with local law enforcement and others. How do you manage regulatory concerns, privacy concerns? You want to be able to share that data, but how do you get the comfort in doing that?
Yeah, so I think you hit it on the head there when you said privacy, because everything starts there. So we don't do anything in our lab or anything with data until we've been through that gauntlet. And luckily, over the past 6 years, we've been able to educate folks in the privacy office, and we have a great privacy officer in S&T, Christopher Lee, as well, who helps us carry that message about what it is we're trying to achieve. And so making sure that privacy and civil rights and liberties are taken care of first and foremost is essential to our making any progress. And so we're continually publishing our privacy impact assessments and thresholds. And so I see that as vital. And then there's the whole organizational culture that surrounds law enforcement. If you're working with state and local law enforcement or other organizations, they all have a culture. They all have their own maturity levels. So what does it mean to serve up data and information to somebody with a badge and a gun? It's a very different experience than working with an intelligence analyst. You know, these are very different, different interfaces, different information needs. And so understanding those is important, and being able to demonstrate how what the technology is doing, what the analytics are doing, actually supports the end mission. Being able to demonstrate that to leadership in law enforcement is also very important.
And does the cloud make this easier, harder, no different?
I think it's made it easier for me. When I've been doing experiments with law enforcement, it's pretty easy for me to work with an end organization and give them access to something that I already have in the cloud. And so there's not a lot of installation. I don't have to worry about what their hardware is, what their networks do. I don't have to worry about necessarily all of their security issues. I bring my own to the table, and we basically give them access, and we conduct experiments with them. And we try to do that in the field where we can see what it means.
And Ed, as we're sharing more data, in the past, authentication has largely been about something you have, something you know, and so on. Where is that moving? Where are we going with authentication?
So we're getting more fine-grained. So, it used to be we had all role-based access, and now we're moving to attribute so that, not only do you say that, you are who you are, but you also have access to that. And then, on the data side, how fine-grained can you get on that as far as, like we were mentioning before, records or parts of records in a database. So the more fine-grained, the better, I think, we're getting, so we can log everything. And, there's lots of things we have to consider now with insider threats and other things. So attribute-based and, knowing who you are is absolutely critical.
And Ray, from your perspective, is this evolving within the Marine Corps?
Well, absolutely, and that one also within the Department of Defense as a whole. I'm sure many of you might have heard that the DoD is involved in what's called the DoD Cybersecurity Scorecard, which was started by the former DoD CIO Tara Halverson after the OPM issues. And then one of the areas we need to look at ourselves to address this, and two of the major points was the aspect of PK implementation and other control implementation for both privileged users and the end users, and of course the websites. And all this translates into the cloud environment the same. It's the same concepts, same theories, sometimes the same tools. But we are finding some difficulties in some of the certificate use. The PK certificate usage doesn't translate well to some other devices and some capabilities if you're not on Active Directory, for example. So we're finding there are some challenges. So we're moving even beyond just the CAC or the hard-based token. We're actually trying to move into other things, to multi-factor authentications with added into the capability of logging in through a PK access approach, but including a one-time password quickly for our privileged users. And key on this too is also to actually audit the privileged users, because as we've learned from things in history, recent history with the issues with NSA and such, is that if you don't have an audit process to see what the privileged user is doing, you may not be able to see if there's the inside threat problems, as alluded earlier. So we have to find that process, particularly in the cloud, to assure we have an audit process to see exactly what that privileged user is doing, when, where, are they exceeding the privileges that they've extended to such, and provide proper insight. Or even trying to exactly right. Exactly.
Well, I'd like to riff on that a little bit in a slightly different direction, but I think an important direction. So, being able to get at insider threat data is important. It's important for two reasons, though. I think characterizing user behavior, decision-making is important for insider threat processes, but it's also important for the productivity of what's going on in these systems. And so I think every day the government and lots of corporations, you know, government's not alone in this, are running huge experiments of sifting through data, getting information, making decisions that are impactful, you know, for business and profit, for government and outcomes. And so why are we throwing all that away, or why are we not capturing that? I mean, I think we're to a point now with the advances in computation, the advances in storage, you know, where we can keep all of that data and it can inform our process. It can make us more mature about what it is we're doing in our system.
Absolutely, totally agree with that. Just a very quick anecdote. I mentioned Symantec earlier. One of the things that we learned in the research organization was you can tell as much about the validity of a piece of software by how it's being used, how it's being downloaded, and what patterns as you can by actually looking at the software itself. The metadata was as valuable as the data. So we've talked about data agility and trying to get more value from the data. We've talked about being authorized and authenticated to do so. We've also talked about sharing that information. What about data residency? You've talked about moving data and moving clouds into forward locations. How do you deal with issues of where the data actually is, either from a geographic perspective or from a perspective of the people operating and sort of owning the data?
Well, for us, again, we're paranoids, personal opinion, within my services. Again, we want to make sure we know where it is. So that becomes a pretty important aspect to us. We need to assure that wherever that data is located, whatever provider is, if we, you know, go to the public, wherever the provider has it, we're going to be able to find where it is, make sure it's isolated, it's not tainted, and there's controls around it. We're also to the point where we want to look at the, you know, what is the out-of-band management aspect? As providers do have to have a responsibility to keep the capabilities going, what permissions are there, too, to assure information is protected? Because, you know, we talked about the privacy aspect. Privacy is one part. I know there's discussion of official use, COI information, aggregation of information, construct, and such. So that becomes our concern. The more we put things out there, as we start moving into more of the FedRAMP level 3s, level 4s, even level 5s that might be out there, we have to be sure that those protection mechanisms are in place, that I can say, okay, my data in, you know, pick your major cloud provider, you may have it at this one location here, but it's in the United States, right? Where people are vetted and working in there. It's not a foreign location where people may not be as vetted. Again, sounding paranoid, but the approach is that, you know, we've seen, sadly, incidents where if it's not taken care of, the information has a sad propensity to be exposed where it's not supposed to be.
Yeah, I was just going to say that, you know, beyond the geographic location, you're so happy in the U.S., you also have, you know, again, you know, people have access to the actual hardware, you know, you can leak data. You know, so we've got efforts to look at the entire stack from the actual hardware all the way up. So we have tamper-proof, you know, FIPS 140-4 tamper-resistant server blades all the way up through the application, so that if anybody tries to jump in the middle, they're taken out. Not physically, but, you know, they're not able to do that. Yeah, that's your job. Yeah.
We have customers who ask us all the time in terms of our encryption capability, gee, I'd really like to be able to have my data in operations in this geography, and I'd like to keep a copy of the data in another geography for disaster recovery purposes, but I'd like to keep the keys someplace else. So that yes, I want the data there, but I don't want anybody to have access to the data until we have an actual disaster and we can authorize that data being used in that location. So you mentioned FedRAMP. Even sort of going beyond FedRAMP, what are the approaches that you're looking at to ensure sort of alignment on security practices, whether it's cloud or not?
But we're just moving into the FedRAMP approach from the Marine Corps. I know that the Navy has done some things, I believe. I think also the Air Force may have as well. And I think it's a good foundation. I like the idea of the three PAs going out, taking a look at the organizations and saying, here's the baseline security aspects. And then I, as the authorizer, the accreditor, would go in, if I needed to look at that and see what's the delta, is it sufficient for me? And then if there is issues, I can work with the provider to adjust it. Or if it is sufficient, move out. But we have to remember, of course, and this is some of the discussions we had a little bit earlier, is that it's a baseline. It's the start. FedRAMP itself is just here. And It doesn't mean that that's the only thing one has to do. That's why when I would come in, and I've done a couple of others, is in discussions, you're going to have to do a little bit more here, or I'm going to have a little more access, or in some cases, I may actually have to have a person on-prem with you who's reporting back to my organizations that are overseeing this for our service cyber component and for cybercom. So it's a little bit more we're having to work with. We're excited to try it. I mean, I'm always, you know, there are organizations we have in Marine Corps Community Services. You know, it's the stores, it's the Navy, the commissaries and the exchanges and such. Do I really need to have them in a .mil kind of environment cluster? Maybe I can push them into things like Azure or Amazon or something like that. So we want to find ways we can put information there. At the same time, we're very proprietary in the aspect, it's our data. We want to make sure that it's appropriately protected.
Yeah, no, I like the fact that it is, you know, the FedRAMP is a baseline. It is your starting point. But continuing to think that you have to know what your application is. You have to know what your reason for going into this environment is. And then also know what opportunities you have for, you know, perhaps nesting your container. So if you have, you know, something that's really critical that you know what the system calls are, that you know that everything's encrypted, you know, you just have a nested container, a nested VM, so that you know that everything that leaves one goes into the other and then goes into the infrastructure that you don't control. So really it's knowledge of what you're trying to do and being flexible enough to do it.
I think in our laboratory we're up to 3 ISOs now for one lab. Because we have all these different security concepts that we're working on, and often we're working on something that the organization hasn't seen before, and there is a lot of pressure to do intra-cloud computation. How is data going to move? Is it going to move? How does it remain encrypted? And yet I get computation at speed. We're going to have increasing pressure to go to real-time data because data is going to flow more and more. We're going to have more sensors pushing information. The computational strategy is going to change. Fragments of information are going to be everywhere. And so we're putting a lot of energy in how to do that so that we can educate the organization as to what's coming and making sure that we move to FISMA and beyond. Yeah.
And you mentioned cross-cloud computing.
Yeah.
So is this notion of cloud neutrality or being able to move between clouds or utilize multiple clouds, is that something that's top of mind in your organizations?
It certainly is in ours. We've already experienced it. We have our own private cloud, of course, and then we're working with some commercial service. They have a cloud in the middle. There might be Amazon. There might be Azure. And so it's just a reality. And I think as folks make acquisition decisions using acquisition rules, you know, they're going to wind up with a variety of different providers.
I mean, you have to be resilient. Yeah. So
yeah.
Redundant service providers is critical. Yeah.
And the DoD, the additional requirement of a cloud access broker helps to make sure that what we're transitioning from our own private clouds with the public clouds, as we work through these hybrid relationships, there's at least some type of consistency across there so that we can have the benefit of it at the same time to assure the protection of the information in transit, at rest, and access. Mm-hmm.
So in this discussion, there's been an undercurrent and sometimes an explicit mention of knowledge of security practices and procedures, and there's a lot of discussion floating around about the gaps that we have in trained personnel. What are we doing? Well, first of all, what is your perception of the gaps, and what do you see being done, and what can be done to make more of us cybersecurity aware?
I'd be happy to take that. So, you know, I mentioned in the intro that we have cybersecurity competition programs. So, you know, to me, I think it's almost incumbent upon all of us to have some base level of knowledge on cybersecurity. You know, I kind of liken it to the fact that, you know, I'm not a doctor, but when my daughter falls and skins her knee, I know enough to put an antiseptic and a Band-Aid on it. And that wasn't always the case. I mean, people would die from cuts and scratches now. You know, I think we're kind of in the analog for that for cybersecurity right now, where we just don't know what needs to be done from a, you know, almost a triage or a, you know, basic first aid point of view. We'll get there, you know, but there's always going to need to be a need for the professionals, the practitioners, if you will. You know, again, likening it to the medical community, I mean, you have doctors and they're, you know, proficient in what they do and they practice all the time. Cybersecurity is a practitioner's career. You know, you have to practice all the time. It's not good enough to go to school, get an education, and say, yeah, I have the knowledge, I'm done. So that's where I think competitions and then, you know, any role-based or, you know, framework-based evaluation is key all the way up through, mature workforces.
I think part of the cloud also exacerbates the problem of cybersecurity appreciation from the end users, because you think we've developed over the past few years, it's now fast, it's free, it's everywhere. And so I think end users fall into a pattern of, well, of course it's going to be okay. Many times I'll discuss the concerns with leadership, and they don't really know what goes on behind the curtain. And so how do I train my end users to stop clicking on the frickin' link, which is, that's the issue, yeah, that technical term there, yeah, and because another technical term, because hanky things happen after that. So how do I get into that? So I've got an end user issue that is a constant, persistent approach that I've got to be able to help them with. At the same time, we do have a delta in our workforce, our cybersecurity workforce, as we're trying to move into other areas and get off of the static of what we've had in the past of just, I'm close by, I know how to fix a router or a switch. Now how do I translate that to across the entire services? We in the Marine Corps, we'll send Marines out once a year to the rifle range. Do I need to train them how to shoot? No, but I do need to have them reattack the basics again, get the fundamentals down, make sure they keep those processes in place and mind to get that muscle memory. We need to do the same thing with our cybersecurity workforce, to have capabilities, much like we have here, you have in DHS, of having competitions and labs, but same thing, remote course, we have a capability called the Cyber Training and Evaluation Platform, a remote virtual platform, it's a Zone B environment, but we want to bring our Marines that are in the particular cybersecurity and cyber MOSs into that once a year and say, okay guys, let's just see if you still know how to do this, to get that level up, because I'm starting to find, we talk about cross-domain issues, or we start talking about classification reuse issues. I'm finding that people don't understand the basics of Bell Lapadula, the no-read-up, no-write-down construct. And if they don't even understand the framework or the theory, how can I expect it to be able to execute when something new or something along the line comes along? So I think it's critical we move along the line.
Okay, shameless plug, yeah. cybercompx.org, cybercompetitionsexchange.org. Have them join.
Be glad to, trust me.
Yeah, and I think I just agree with everything you guys just said, and I think the same thing is happening in data analytics. You know, we don't have enough folks who actually understand how to use data to make decisions and whatnot. I thought it was interesting to see that Berkeley has decided to train all undergraduates in data science. And if you're majoring in English, you're taking data science for 4 credits. And this enables you then to do data science within your field later. And so you get this core training. Everybody gets it. And I think that we need to look at cyber analytics. Some of these capabilities need to be started in the educational process much earlier. It ought to be inculcated. If you read Daniel Kahneman's book, Thinking Fast and Thinking Slow, it's all about your mental model. You know, how rich is that model? Well, we shouldn't be too surprised if we have done nothing to prepare the model to think deeper and to take the corrective actions that are necessary.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. And I think it also relates to the point Ray made about end users. In yes, they're not going to be security experts. Not everyone can be or should be a security expert. But building the model about, oh, links take me to places and do things. Those may be things I don't want to happen. Kind of instilling that very broadly, I think is really important. And also just the notion that, you know, in the security industry in general, we tend to focus on the big sexy threats, you know, the newest advanced persistent threat that's being used. And, you know, the fact of the matter is, the bad guys don't have to work that hard most of the time, because the bar is very low in a lot of organizations, and we need to get that bar up. We also need to worry about advanced persistent threats and advanced attacks, but bringing that bar up, making them work a little bit harder or a lot harder to get in, I think is critically important. We talked about cloud from the security perspective, both from the perspective of new threats may be there, but also from the perspective of what it can do actually to help you from a threat perspective. What are And I'll start with you, Ray. From the Marine Corps' perspective, are there opportunities with the cloud for existing programs? Is it really, you know, we're just doing greenfield in the cloud, but the old stuff stays where it is? What's kind of the mix that's being...
Well, I'm glad you brought that up. Yeah, there's things we're doing within the Marine Corps and, of course, the DoD overall. Within the Marine Corps, we are actually moving many of our old programs that have been around for a while and pushing them into the cloud, getting off some of the older operating systems, off the older platforms, to make sure that they can take advantage of some of the cost savings and ability for security controls for protections. But within the DoD, we're looking at aspects of email overall. Why do I need to have my own local email capability when we can have something more into the cloud? And so the old Office 365 construct is starting to come around. So just some ideas.
Is that a thought within your organizations as well in terms of which types of applications or services might be more amenable to be moving to the cloud? Is it really we're just going to do new things in the cloud, but the old stuff stays where it is, or is there a broad view in what might be used?
I'll jump in. So I think there's absolutely a looking at what we have currently and whether or not there's sufficient advantage to moving to the cloud. You know, I think the extending the life of older applications, absolutely, that's one thing that can be realized. But, you know, it's in some ways delaying the inevitable, but, you know, it gives you the time to prepare for actually updating the real systems.
Right.
And I think it depends on sort of the maturity level of the program manager. I think there are a lot of advantages you could get out of moving to the cloud. It frees up resources to do more. And so folks who are so inclined to do that, and I haven't seen this divide along old versus new, you know, I think everybody wants to get economies of scale.
Right. And then as they're doing that, you all bring an expertise in this area in looking at, again, from a security perspective, a defense in depth approach. And are there new things that we need to be thinking about in terms of defense in depth in the cloud, or again, new opportunities for defense in depth in the cloud?
So again, I would perhaps change that a bit to be not just defense in depth, where you have multiple layers of defense, but also resiliency. You know, because you really need to be able to continue whatever your mission or application is in compromised environments. You know, so being able to just plow through and say, you know, hey, you know, we've been compromised, but we're still able to fulfill our goals is key, and I think that's enabled with the cloud.
Same principles. It's the same principles. The same hardware, software, firmware, construct. So the things I do locally that I manage, I would expect to do in the cloud as well.
And more, because you can have, with the virtualization, you're
absolutely
able to put a lot more security controls and auditing and logging based on the fact that you have containers and virtualization.
I think some of the work that, you know, Ed's been doing in the cybersecurity division, you know, focuses on how to improve that that security profile. We've been trying to deploy, you know, some of the solutions that are coming out of that division in our lab so that we can see what is the impact of these different security postures on our ability to compute or to get results, or what's the overhead, what is the cost, those kind of things.
So I just got the signal to stop asking questions and let the audience chime in. So we're gonna turn to you, and I think we have a roving microphone if there are questions from the audience.
I got one.
Right here in front.
I have to talk loud.
Okay.
So actually, my name is Bruce Lawyer. Well, I actually
don't mind saying so, like, sorry, we're recording, so then my friend.
Okay, gotcha. So my name is Gary. My name is Eric Holden. I was also previously with Symantec, now with DLT Solutions. So my question is, as you talk about the cloud expanding there, the perimeter also expands, you tend to lose a little bit more visibility. How do you rein in that perimeter as we have staff that you use, bring your own devices, or even IoTs in your environment? How do you still manage that expansion without compromising workplace efficiency as well?
Absolutely. So the endpoints are critical. You know, so that as you have more controls over your containers, and as containers become more secure, you know, I think you can have less of a shall we say threat at the perimeter. You know, so if you control the endpoints You know, a lot of the times, if you send your perimeter out, you know, that's fine because you don't, you know, what does it matter in the middle? You know, if all your traffic's encrypted from your endpoints, you know, if somebody intercepts your traffic, okay. But then there's also routing protocols that you can put in there so that you can't be tampered with in the middle. But I think the key is controlling the endpoints. Like you said, you know, as we get better and better and we have more flexibility in the cloud, the burden on the endpoints becomes less and you get better security, better logging, better auditing capabilities.
Or if we fold into the approach within the DoD and with the Marine Corps, the risk management framework, doing moving back to something you probably haven't heard in a long time called type accreditation. And I'm sure people are kind of, oh yeah, I remember that in the Orange Book days. But it's a way for us to say, let us control the actual end device framework construct. Do you want a particular endpoint? This is the only one you're going to have. This is the only configuration you're going to have. This is the only construct it's going to be, and this is how you're going to use it. So now I may have more, but they're all going to be of that same approach, that same framework. Even the endpoint of these, how can I control tablets and end devices as well to start establishing that same construct with the type of accreditation? We're looking at a five types of just tablet and end device, mobile devices alone to say, you're using this, this is the protection. You're using this tactically, this we have to have. You want to use for office automation. You want to use this for Marine Corps recruiting. You know, there are very distinct aspects that we're controlling those to help control that perimeter. Ties in just exactly what we're saying.
So actually, the multi-persona on the devices is important to address, you know, and acknowledge the fact that, you know, people are going to have, you know, their work environment and their personal environment on different devices, or on the same device, and then making sure that the division between those is hard.
And I think Ed's being a little humble. He's run pilots of technology in this area, and I found myself using these devices and being at least twice as productive and carrying half the equipment. By demonstration, I think there's a lot possible. Yeah, absolutely, getting the organizations to adopt it and manage that way more of a challenge.
Okay. Yes, right back here.
Hi, Renee Goff, and I actually do work for Homeland Security. My question to you is: you talked about a little bit about auditing. You talked about PII. My question is: how do you look at the cloud and determine that insider threat is not threatening those particular areas within the cloud?
You know, that's kind of the overarching approach you're trying to do, even within internal, within our own internal systems, not just cloud. You're right. The insider threat has been more of an increasing issue we've had recently. Obviously, I'm sure many of you can raise your hand, mentally do so. How many of you received a letter because of OPM? And then some of us, how many of you received three letters on it? So we're all very sensitive to this. So a lot of it is, as we're talking about containerization, you know, locking down with the encryption, making sure that we monitor and control people who are privileged users to make sure they only have the privileges they need to get access. Part of the OPM problem we discovered, we had a replay of the privileged user credentials. So you had the same one being used by multiple people, so you had no auditing. So this is the lessons learned that actually has been part of our construct and a profession for years. But now we're saying, okay, here's something where we just let it go. We're all re-attacking it. And particularly since cloud is moving in the way it is, we've got to make sure that because it's not distributed, we can't see it, we have assurance it's still being done at the end.
Great. Well, thank you very much. We've gotten the out of time signal. So thank you all for coming and for your questions.